Imagine a god made being with aliens just hovering around watching from afar and depressed and excited, waiting for God to get done with this being so that they could move in from all planets, wanting to be the first ones there to leave an impression on this new race, wondering what it's like due to it being made in God's image, what kind of powers it may have. If they're the first to intermingle, will their race actually be superior to every other alien race out there since they intermingled with that race called the human being? And then God makes that being and they all rush in to share their culture with this being, to intermingle and become friends with this being, maybe even become part of this being by breeding. So they do all that. They show this being how to build pyramids, things of that nature. They're intertwined with culture now. They're friends. They're normal with each other now. They're used to seeing each other on a daily basis. It's like seeing each other. And then all of a sudden, another being comes out of the sky, sort of like the human beings, but with wings. Now the aliens know what these things are. They know that they're too powerful. So the aliens rush to get away, hurt inside, angry at them, because they know what's about to happen. They know these dirty fallen angels are too powerful for them, and they're coming to tank the human race and erase their culture as well with the human race. So they sit back from afar and watch these fallen angels dirty up the human race, knowing that once they're done, there will be nothing left to marvel about this race except for maybe the statues and the structures they helped that human race to build. Sort of like when we take pictures with a superstar. Well, that's how they see us. When they look at their structures, that's all they have to remind them of us. Because we're so far removed from God now due to tainting of the dirty fallen angels. And we're so set on the wrong course that we're no longer set up for perfection anymore. And the alien race doesn't want anything to do with us. They feel bad for us because they know we're far gone and there's no turning back. We build nukes every day. We're just set for destruction. No matter what we do, we're set for destruction. And that alien race, they're nervous. They don't want anything to do with us because they don't want part of this judgment that the angels, fallen angels, have gotten, which is to be doused against rocks, thrown in dungeons and caves, in reservoirs, chained up under rivers. These angels sit and await their judgment in the harshest conditions, only to be going to harsher conditions. And aliens don't want anything to do with it. So they sit back and wait for our judgment to see if we'll get a great reset or if we may just get wiped out. But the aliens just sit back in anticipation and wait, which is why they don't want to speak to us or talk to us anymore. They know it's not our fault, but they know also that they don't want anything to do with us anymore. That's how strong the influence of the fallen angels were. And Lucifer still goes to heaven. So they know his work may not be done with us. So just imagine that.
We have the Army for land, the Navy for sea, and the Air Force, which has historically covered the defense of both air and space. So why do we need another military service branch of the US Armed Forces? The US Air Force was established back in 1947 out of a need for the US to become dominant in aerial combat and surveillance, a reality that became apparent during World War I and a necessity by the end of World War II. If space is the final frontier and much of our day-to-day lives depend on space operations, it makes sense to protect what we have. Here's what you need to know about the Space Force. To amend and modify the treaty as needed to accommodate ideas and concerns of other nations seeking to follow suit. The Other Partnership. Elon Musk's SpaceX is looking to not only carry paying customers to outer space, but eventually Mars. Jeff Bezos' Blue Origin has a similar goal, but nowhere near as ambitious. Both companies know that the key to passenger flight into and exceeding Earth's orbit are reusable launch vehicles as cheap methods to get them off planet and back onto it. The formation of the Space Force has prompted these companies to up the ante on their test flights, with both having successful and sometimes unsuccessful launch mission results. Obviously, a partnership with either the civilian-led NASA or military-led Space Force, or both, would be extremely beneficial in making either SpaceX or Blue Origin the first and perhaps go-to company for space travel. SpaceX has
Well, there's been a lot of activity of earthquakes and a lot of movement of tectonic plates going on as pressure has been applied from the atmosphere up on the Earth. And also there's movement in the core of the Earth. And then if you want to throw in Planet X, some gigantic body, a planet of some sort, what is it, Planet 7X? Is it Planet X? Is it Nibiru? But anyway, 10 times larger than the Earth has been pulling a gravitational pull on the Earth, okay? These things we know.
I started looking further afield from regular literature and stumbled upon a book by Zechariah Sitchin named The 12th Planet. And this is outside of a normal field of view, and I thought it was interesting. Sitchin's theory was that the Sumerians were aware of this planet, and that it there was a planet in our solar system, what he called a 12th planet, which came in and out of our solar system on a regular basis. Orbital path was like that of a long period comet, but it was actually the size of a planet, maybe 3 to 5 times the mass of Earth or larger. And he believes that the Sumerians were aware of this planet, and then they recorded it in their creation epic called Enuma Elish, which means, and I wrote an entire book on the subject, not only about the creation of the Earth, but also the nativity. And of course, the second coming, which I was focusing on, where I believe that Planet X will return and the battle between God and the dragon will resume. That is to say, Planet X and Earth. And that's really the subject of the book, Planet X, the sign of the Son of Man and the end of the age. It's like, this is the resumption of an old battle, which will reoccur again in the end times, and which actually is described in the Bible as the resurgence of this dragon character, who's mentioned in Revelation 12. And this is a resumption of this old battle, and Planet X will return, and there will be another conflict between Earth and Planet X, which will result in a catastrophic end to human civilization.
And then it says, a great star falls from heaven, burning like a lamp. It fell on the third part of the rivers and fountains of waters, and the name of the star is called Wormwood. And the third part of the waters become wormwood, or bitter. Many men die of the waters because they're made bitter or poisonous, or let's just say radiation. Anytime a meteorite or an asteroid or something comes from the heaven and hits the Earth, it brings with it a ton of radiation, which would make waters polluted and you couldn't drink it. So what causes it? What could shake the heavens, send asteroids or comets crash into the Earth, creating a catastrophic, cataclysmic, apocalyptic event? And then you look at the destroyer, Planet X is sometimes called, you know, Nibiru, or the destroyer, you know. And now we're hearing NASA say that something is pulling on the probe around Saturn, pulling on all the planets, the moons of the planets, pulling on something hidden, something somewhere is pulling. It's a gravitational pull. And we see earthquakes and volcanic eruptions last year. We broke the record for most earthquakes over 6.0 last year. And we broke the record for most volcanic eruptions last year. And we're blowing the world away with sinkholes. And we've never even heard of such a thing. And so something's happening, okay? And something's causing it to happen. But it actually, Jesus said it in Luke 21. And the Bible prophesies it in Revelation 8. So that's where I'm seeing that a Planet X doesn't have to hit us. It's just what it does in the effect is what I truly believe is causing and is going to cause major events on the Earth, is in its Bible prophecy.
Yeah, the more I personally hear about different theories and things about Planet X, the more that I'm becoming convinced too.
Wow, I do sincerely apologize for making you all watch that. I mean, if there is anyone even still watching at this point, I don't know, maybe not. I'm sorry to make you suffer through that, but there was a purpose for it. Obviously, to provide context for what I wanted to say on this topic. Why are we talking about Planet X? I mean, why is anyone talking about Planet X? You know, for me, that's really the point that I've been on for quite some time now, is in the last last few years, it's really been increasingly popular amongst, you know, Bible prophecy, conspiracy type teachers and stuff. And it wasn't always like this. You know, when I first started looking into prophecy and conspiracy and things like that, you know, this Planet X was more or less relegated to the realms of the whole New Age side of the truth movement and the 2012ers and all this sort of thing. And I think thanks largely to several of the people that I just showed, like guys like Doug Elwell and Paul Begley, you know, a lot more people are starting to, a lot more Christians are starting to kind of give serious thought to the idea of Planet X fitting into Bible prophecy somehow, or at least they're willing to talk about it, you know, without just laughing and mocking and attacking it the way that Flat Earth is. And I suppose that that's one of the things that just by itself kind of is fascinating, is that, like, I mean, even within the realm of, you know, a strictly Copernican paradigm, you know, as far out there as the whole Planet X Nibiru idea is, people will still, you know, they'll still hear it out. They'll still kind of, it still doesn't get the treatment that Flat Earth does. You know, nothing does. But, you know, when I listened to that, like, I just had to include this clips of this Paul Begley guy. If you don't know who Paul Begley is, he's, you know, he's like an ex-preacher who's now kind of moved to a YouTube ministry type thing, and he's just on there every day talking about stuff, and he has like 130,000 subscribers or something like that, and like 8,000 videos on his channel. It's kind of insane. So, you know, there's a lot of people listening to this guy, a lot of people digging what he's saying, and he is 100% on board with Planet X. And as you can see, it's interesting because his idea, you know, I never really, you know, Planet X was something that I never really gave serious consideration to. You know, I just was like, I mean, even when I believed in the globe and everything, it was like, how could that even work? You know, how's a planet going to be undetected and then come in and impact the Earth without killing everyone? And, you know, so now there's a lot of people kind of grabbing onto this idea that it's just, oh, it's this, the gravitational pull of this hidden planet that's affecting, you know, causing all these earthquakes and natural disasters, and tying it to Revelation. And, you know, it's just amazing because he, I mean, he just says all these things like he really believes this is his, you know, his understanding of how gravitational theory works. You know, gravity can do anything. You and I don't feel the gravitational pull of Planet X, but it affects things in the Earth. And yeah, I don't know. I'm not even going to go off on that. But, you know, the whole thing is interesting because, you know, for a long time, ever since I started getting into Flat Earth research and, you know, thinking about the implications thereof, and, you know, obviously you start to realize how Flat Earth, or how cosmology, you know, Copernican cosmology really sets the foundations for evolutionary theory. So, you know, in an enclosed system, evolution just falls apart, like, right away. And then as an extension of that, the whole idea of aliens who would have evolved in distant galaxies, and the whole alien paradigm falls apart, and you start to see all the connections and how it all fits together. And so what I had, you know, kind of wrestled over is like, well, I know that there's lots of people who, they won't give Flat Earth the time of day, but they still fully are aware of the fact that evolution is a lie, and or that the whole alien deception agenda. And, you know, so what, you know, does enclosed cosmology really, you know, make a huge amount of difference when it comes to eschatology and end times deception? You know, how could it still be a major, you know, major key element to the great deception, the last days deception, if a lot of people can kind of figure these sorts of things out without Flat Earth, right? And that's why I think this whole Planet X topic is so interesting, because it's like, so even with all these people that, you know, they're, you know, they have awareness about the lie of evolution, they have awareness about the whole alien deception and all the, you know, the little avenues thereof, and probably know a lot more about it than I do, you know. But because they're still firmly in this heliocentric Copernican cosmology, you know, then you introduce something like this Planet X idea, and either just dismiss it outright based on conventional ideas of heliocentric cosmology and gravity and making it impossible and everything, or it goes the other way, and suddenly they're like Paul Bagley, who's interpreting practically everything in Revelation through this naturalistic, you know, gravitational paradigm. Like, gravity is what's responsible for everything he reads in Revelation and sees going on, of fish die-offs and sinkholes, and, you know, it's all gravity, which is interesting, because obviously if you're, you know, becoming convinced by flat earth evidence, that's certainly not, you know, you're not going to fall for that kind of explanation whatsoever. You know, it's nonsense. So to me, it's just really an interesting topic to consider, like how a further like layer of deception can be injected into people that they do understand a lot. They understand a lot of the New World Order agenda, but yet, I mean, here you have this guy talking about wormwood in Revelation, and you know what the scripture says is just, it's like right in your face, and he's just blind to it because of everything he's injecting into the text and just filtering it all through. You know, I mean, the whole thing of wormwood is amazing, because it's describing this this event, and this, and it's really it calls it an angel, but it also describes it as a mountain, a burning mountain that comes in, and it actually does describe it as hitting the earth, not just, you know, having a gravitational effect on it or something. It is an impact, but it's a being. It has a name. You know, it's called a star. So all these definitions are simultaneously being tied together in this one verse, and it's one of the most powerful scriptural evidences of, I think, this whole, you know, angelic, heavenly, you know, enclosed cosmology, this biblical enclosed cosmology that we're talking about, where the stars and the angels are inextricably linked and in a very undeniable way. And yet it's right in front of his face, and he's trying to make it about gravity and radiation and all this stuff. And, you know, it just kind of amazes me. I'm not saying that I have some elaborate prediction of how this sort of deception linked with you know, this resurgence of Planet X, you know, teaching, you know, trying to link it to Bible prophecy, exactly how that deception would play out. You know, it's just something that is very, it's very worthwhile to keep an eye on and to kind of see is just an avenue that I hadn't really thought of until this, you know, last 6 months or so, in terms of another layer of deception that is still sucking people in who, you know, they are aware of a lot of the other pieces, but this is one that, you know, can kind of work in a number of angles and a number of directions. And so I'm still kind of examining what all those possibilities are, but you know, it's just very interesting to think about, in terms, especially in light of what I'm sure most of us are familiar with, like with what von Braun said at the end of his life to his secretary. And
they will first have the Cold War, then we decided there would be nations of concern, then global terrorism. We have this
across much of South Florida, ranging from the Keys to Broward County, and some caught the confusion on camera, but many are still wondering, what was it?
Local 10 News went looking for some answers, and Christian De La Rosa has the story live from Fort Lauderdale. Christian.
Yeah, well, BSO got a lot of calls about this. We got a lot of calls about this. I can tell you it wasn't an earthquake based on what experts are telling us. The Naval Air Station in Key West telling us it wasn't them. So at this hour, what caused this big shake that so many people felt? Still a mystery. South Florida feeling the rumble.
What's going on here?
In Broward, the sheriff's office flooded with phone calls.
Almost like someone was opening and closing the door.
I thought it was an earthquake. I've never been in an earthquake before.
In Homestead, people tweeting it went on for 15 seconds, even down in Monroe County.
Where are we having these mini earthquakes.
That was weird as
f***. We've had several phone calls about people reporting shaking.
The United States Geological Survey telling Local 10 News what may have felt like a small earthquake did not register.
We got reports of people experiencing shaking in the South Florida area around 1:15 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Our computers did not locate any earthquakes automatically, so we looked at all the seismometers and we did not detect any earthquake activity.
So we still have calls out to the Air Force. We can tell you that several of our viewers in the Miami-Dade County area did report seeing military air jets flying overhead during these hours that these shakes were felt between 1 and 4 o'clock. I can tell you that USGS expert that we spoke to tell us that based on what people are describing, this shake, this rumble that lasted about 15 seconds, didn't register as an earthquake, but it does seem to fit the description of a sonic boom. We'll keep you posted on this one. For now, we're live in Fort Lauderdale. I'm Christian Dolorosa, Local 10.
Water levels continue to be a concern for people along Lake Michigan, but a lackluster winter has helped a little bit after a record-breaking 2020.
Yeah, that's a little bit of good news. Experts say that we still need to keep a close eye, though. Eric Estreva is in our newsroom with the forecast for the spring and summer. Eric.
Doug, Annie, the below normal winter precipitation helped to lower the stress levels a bit here, not only in the weather center, but for those that live along Lake Michigan. This combined with the typical seasonal low for water levels on Lake Michigan has brought those levels down about a foot compared to last year. Now, last March, we had a record high level of 581.43 feet, and now we are sitting at 580.69 feet, so that's about 0.74 feet difference. And while it's a step in the right direction, we are still more than 2 feet above March's average level. As we head into the month of April, lake levels will begin to rise again as we get into the heavier spring rains and snow to our north continues to melt and pour into the lakes. Today I sat down with Deanna Apps, a physical scientist with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers out in Detroit to discuss the forecast and what we need to see to continue our positive trend down towards average.
So as we go forward in time, you know, if these drier conditions persist, you know, we'll hopefully we'll see not as high of peaks as we did last year. But, you know, a lot of that is still, you know, still determined what Mother Nature brings us over these next 6 months. With the Great Lakes system being as large as it is, it really takes several months to years of persistent wet or dry conditions to get these water levels to move, you know, significantly in one direction or the other.
And the current table on your screen right now shows that we have been keeping below 2020's levels for the last 3 months.
Something
and even with the peak coming here in the next few months,
Powell,
we are
and
expected
its history
to continue
remains
to stay
a mystery.
Now, I'm curious, are you? The group that made the discovery explains how they actually spotted it. And as Lauren Steinbrecher reports, is a sign of just how little water is in the reservoir.
Some have never seen the Lake Powell shoreline like this.
It's lower than we've ever seen with the water. It's pretty crazy.
So low that boat ramps closed and new things sat exposed, as Liz Bowles discovered during a friends and family fishing trip last weekend.
Where we camped is usually underwater. It was there was a few, you know, things like soda cans and things like that we cleaned up.
It gave them a new camping spot and revealed some trash long hidden underwater. When the group of boats headed back on Sunday,
we just came around the corner and
they spotted something on the shrunken shoreline.
It wasn't until somebody had pointed out that it was all the way out of the water, so we just kind of puttered over to it and
wedged in the rocks, a shipwrecked boat.
We could actually go right up to it and get out and kind of walk around it. It was cool to see it. You know, around it were a few things that, you know, belonged to the boat, and we tried to not disturb it too much because, you know, we don't know how secure it is there and we didn't want anyone to get hurt. But we could see that there had been some people that had tried to recover it at some point. There were straps on it and things like that, that they were obviously unsuccessful at getting the boat out of the water.
The boat is certainly out of water now because of extreme drought.
And not only is it dry, but this is the second dry year.
that we've seen in a row.
The U.S. Bureau of Reclamation explains Lake Powell is projected to hit 31% capacity this year. Right now, it's at 36%. They have a water management plan in place, but if it continues to drop...
The levels that we're projected to reach haven't been seen since it started filling in 1969.
Which means...
things are being seen now that haven't been seen for a while. And as people explore different areas of Powell, they're going to have a new experience.
While this boat's story remains a mystery, it's making for quite the story from Liz's trip.
Yeah, it was just kind of a cool little find.
Lauren Steinbrecher, Fox 13 News.
Louisiana. Deadly flooding in Louisiana. 11 people lost their lives. 11, and more than 40,000 homes are underwater now. The damage is extensive, we can report. A third of the state's parishes qualify for emergency federal aid. Officials say since the weekend, 30,000 people now have been rescued. Nearly 3 feet of rain fell on parts of the state. Just misery for many parts of Louisiana. You can see the pictures really tell the story.
Just feel so helpless. I mean,
that's right.
Homes are underwater, not much you could do about it.
Don't give them enough credit for the past. They had enough knowledge to know what was coming even at certain time. Remember, there are certain civilizations in around Turkey that went underground. Their entire town went underground They built cities underground.
That's right.
Well, a meteor shower would drive people underground. And this is where, this is a chart that I use for Revelation. This lower section is seal six. If you follow the seals, that talks about what's going to happen right down here. And it says that 5 months later, seal seven, that's this one, where wormwood, a large meteor, is going to hit Earth, where Earth wobbles like a drunkard. In Isaiah right here, are you able to read that?
Yes, the Earth is broken up.
Okay. This is because this large meteor is hitting us, and this is where he says the Earth is broken up, the Earth is split, the Earth is violently shaken, the Earth reels like a drunkard, it sways like a hut in the wind. Wouldn't that be an accurate description from space, looking at Earth being hit, if it was hit by a fiery mountain?
I mean, literally? That's pretty intense.
Now, if you read, is it this one? I think it's this one right here. No, let's throw it down. Let's see what it says. This is where it says the fish of the sea and the birds of heaven are having a problem. Beasts of the field. It says the face of earth is shaken. And there's another one. I don't have it on this particular.
Mountain shall be thrown down. That's.
Yeah. I have another on my newer one, another little scroll piece that talks about where night will become day and day will become night. Now, that's literally talking about a 12-hour delay in Earth's rotation. When you put those two together in the same sentence.
You know, we're looking at what's going on right now in the current state of affairs, and with the news reports coming out and openly admitting that there is a Planet X out there, but they're given different locations on where it is. Where are some places in the U.S. that you feel would be safe for people to go to? Because most people aren't going to be able to make it out to Jerusalem, realistically.
Well, I don't really try to recommend that because people will seize on that, so I will have to pass on that, but the Bible clearly says nowhere on earth you should live on the coastline. Okay. I would say at least 100 to 200 miles away from the coast. 150 at least. Anywhere along the coast. And that includes the Great Lakes or any large body of water, because when the earth starts to tilt, that water in those lakes are going to either move north or south, or it's going to, you know, water wants to stand still while the crust is moving until it catches up to speed. So living by a large lake can be hazardous.
Be a lake or something. And then also, if the poles do shift, then some places that are currently cold are going to have a warmer climate at that specific time. Do you think that having a year's supply of food is good, 6 months, longer than that? What would you recommend?
Well, if they don't plan to be on Mr. Jerusalem, then they have to try to make it through the Great Tribulation.
Okay, and you said that's 3.5 years, right?
3.5 years plus this 1 year right now that you're supposed to have as well, because they're going to start rationing food. So you can't buy your food after rationing, because it doesn't matter how much money, they're not allowing it. So you have to buy it before the bail-in happens.
Okay.
And
you think that's going to happen, the bail-in, are you referring to like similar to what happened back in 2008?
No, I'm saying we haven't seen anything like what's fixing to come here.
Like Depression, early 1930s style, or 1920s?
I would say more more encompassing. That was just more or less local. We're talking about global bail-in almost. Anything financial, because it's a global system today. We have global markets.
Indeed.
We haven't seen anything like what's fixing to come here. I can...
Fire crisis in the West. That Dixie fire engulfing an area larger than the size of Los Angeles. Flames are raging through California right now, and our Real Car is live on the ground in Grass Valley, California. Good morning to you, Will.
And good morning, TJ. We are hearing terrifying stories of residents who tried to stick it out here as the flames raced towards this community. They picked up hoses, they sprayed down their properties, but in the end, this fire was just too much, destroying at least 20 homes across this area. Thousands of people are still evacuated as these fires continue to scorch the West Coast.
This morning, raging fires ripping through California, flames forcing thousands to evacuate. River fire pushed by dangerous winds and fueled by bone-dry brush sweeping through two counties in Northern California.
50 years of stuff is gone.
Flames and wind forming this smoke nado and taking aim at the town of Colfax, over 75 buildings destroyed there.
This fire burned through here so fast and so hot, and incinerated cars, burned homes, and residents here away.
This woman getting to her parents' home just minutes before their house caught fire. The Dixie Fire in Northern California turning skies red in Lassen County and Susanville. This after the fire demolished the town of Greenville.
It just got like this thing goes all hell broke loose.
Fire has burned for more than 3 weeks, engulfing an area the size of Los Angeles. Residents in Chester now fleeing their homes as the flames approach.
It's devastating. It's really my first home. We took a load of stuff, so this is just sentimental.
With more than 88% of California experiencing extreme drought, wildfires have ravaged the state, burning more than 656,000 acres so far.
The extreme conditions leading to Lake Orville's lowest water level since September 1977. Hyatt Power Plant, which relies on the lake now, will go offline for the first time in its history, leading to the fear of potential power outages.
Fire crews across the state are battle weary, they're exhausted, they've been working around the clock, and we have to send them much love, because for every home that you see like this, we also see homes that are still standing. They're sleeping outside of those homes overnight, trying to do everything they can in case there are flare-ups to continue to protect these properties. TJ.
Yeah, Will, it's very good to remind us to show them some love as well. Thank you.
Hi everyone, George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel, and don't forget to download the ABC News app.
Thousands to evacuate. The flames have been fanned by Greece's worst heat wave in more than 3 decades. As some smaller blazes are brought under control, residents who have been forced to flee are trying to return home. Many are asking if authorities could have acted sooner. Our correspondent Barbara Vesel reports from Athens.
To go in. Police and a firefighter are arguing with the old lady. You must come with us. It's too dangerous, they say. This is my house. Let me go in. I'm not leaving. But in the end, the police wins. Down the road, a group of volunteers is fighting a heroic battle. They have commandeered an ancient truck and are trying to save their neighborhood with one fire hose a lot of muscle power and desperation. But small fires are constantly rekindling on the hillside of this protected nature reserve, part of the green lung of Athens. The place is on fire. We lost the most precious piece of Athens. We grew up here. We're hurting and crying because of this catastrophe. Further up, the professionals have moved in and a small rescue operation gets underway. One of the volunteers has hurt his leg climbing up the steep terrain. Meanwhile, outside help has arrived from France, Israel, Bulgaria, and other European countries. Here, it's Cypriot firefighters trying to shoulder the burden. The situation is really difficult. It's tragic. We work together and help our Greek colleagues. We face a much worse situation here than we had expected. Where the firefighters came too late, there is total devastation. Volunteers are battling on with shovels to extinguish the stubborn flames. A disaster. They're burning our country. This was a virgin forest and they burned it. It's so sad. Not only is the forest gone here, the animals are suffering. Somebody left this donkey when fleeing the area. Neighbors are now trying to help. His owner left it behind here to die from the fire. Thousands of animals have already died in these flames. In a few weeks, the fires may be gone, but it's going to take decades for these hills to heal again.
DW correspondent Barbara Wessel filed that report, and she joins us now from Athens. Barbara, good to see you. Another night of battling fires. How are people coping where you are?
People getting increasingly angry, and they are really battling. I mean, I've never seen so many volunteers out. Whole neighborhoods have come out. Everybody who can carry a hose or a shovel or a hoe is trying to climb up on those hillsides and sort of extinguish the fires. They're really stubborn because the forest floor has burned and there is so much burnable material there that it just comes up again and just rekindles all the time, as we have seen. And it is really desperate. And the more people fight, the more angry and, of course, the more sad they get. It is a really difficult situation. Overall, it has become a bit better because the government has doubled the number of firefighters in the area from 400 to 800. And they have, during the day yesterday, made a big difference. They have brought the fires under control, at least, so they're not raging anymore, sort of, and jumping into new neighborhoods. They're keeping the flames in place, but still, it's not over yet. It's still ongoing, particularly in other parts of the Greek mainland, where in one area 70% of the forest and of the whole area has burned down. People there are in utter despair.
You mentioned, Barbara, in your report earlier that the aftermath of the wildfires, is there already talk of how to rebuild?
Of course it is. I mean, the Prime Minister, Mitsotakis, he has been keen to go on television a lot, trying to send out consoling messages, telling people he feels with them. And he also promised yesterday that he would replant all those forests around Athens, which are really so important for the ecological survival of this huge built-up city. But that is a promise easily made and very difficult to really implement. Because how are you going? These are decades old forests. Those are indigenous forests. Replant the trees, it's going to take 20 years at least till something can grow again. Plus, people we talked to on those hills said what will happen in the winter once the rains come is that we will have the most horrible landslides because all the soil is going to come dumping, you know, falling down those hills. So one catastrophe might follow on the other.
Barbara, thank you very much. DW correspondent Barbara Wessel in Athens. Now, while parts of Greece continue to burn, other parts of southern Europe, the Mediterranean and Russia are also battling blazes. Fires in Turkey have claimed at least 8 lives. Meanwhile, hundreds of fires are burning in Kosovo. Blazes in North Macedonia have forced the government to declare a state of emergency there, and fires in Albania have threatened homes. Wildfires in Siberia and Russia's Far East are still burning several weeks after they ignited. There, dozens of villages have been evacuated.
Frequencies of ultraviolet light to detect fluorescence in the area of the object. About 60% presented with positive UV light fluorescence with color ranges from pink, green to yellow.
In June of 2001, President Bush came on scene on ABC News, and it was carried throughout the networks and in Popular Mechanics magazine. He had with him a general from the Air Force, and he was announcing that the general was going to be the head of a new military force called the Space Force. And they were going to build this force and also put a military base on the moon. Now, nobody questioned him on why, what was the purpose for that. But then September 11th comes around, the terrorist attack comes, this general is posted as the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and the Space Force never comes about. The question I have still, why did he want to create a new military force for outer space unless there's a threat?
We have one. We have a space. We have a space force. It's in existence. And it's been written about extensively. It's there.
One more observation before I begin what I want to say. And that is that we spent quite a bit of time talking about the 66-year-old cadavers. And I was glad to have Linda this morning finally say that there are live ETs on Earth at this present time. And at least two of them probably working with the United States government. The other species that I learned about not too long ago was called the Tall Whites. And this is when Paula Harris broke the story just a few years ago. And through her good offices, I had the chance to talk for about 3 hours with former Airman Charles Hall and listen to this absolutely fascinating story of how he was working with, first of all, he was scared out of his skin, but after that, when he got to know them, how he was working with, and finally they became to trust each other and have a good working relationship with the Tall Whites at the gunnery range at Indian Springs in Nevada.
Jesus explains, cut short those days, referring to Matthew 24:22, exactly how, when, and why. Narrated by Daniel. And except those days be shortened, there should no flesh be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. What did I mean? Shall the 1,260 days of great tribulation be cut short for the sake of Christians? As Christians, you don't need your flesh saved. For if you die in Christ, or are alive and remain at my appearing, you shall all put on immortality when I appear in the clouds, immediately after the tribulation of those 1,260 days. Then how, when, and why shall those days be shortened? Allow me to explain and illustrate with a timeline. After the rapture, there are three events that still need to happen before my millennial reign begins on earth. The marriage supper of the Lamb, the outpouring of the vials of God's wrath, and the battle of Armageddon. You may have never considered what I am about to present. Therefore, I encourage you to search the scriptures to see if these things be so. The rapture shall happen when the sun and the moon go dark, immediately after the 1,260 days of Great Tribulation. Then, for 30 days following the rapture, the marriage supper of the Lamb shall take place in heaven, while the vials of God's wrath are poured out upon earth. The sixth vial dries the River Euphrates to prepare the way for the Battle of Armageddon to follow. Then, immediately following the marriage supper of the Lamb, I shall return to earth with the armies of heaven for the 45-day Battle of Armageddon, to cut short those days of great trouble and save the remnant of Israel. And except those days be cut short, the Antichrist and his forces would kill the remnant of Israel. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. When I return to earth for the Battle of Armageddon to save the remnant of Israel, who shall form the 12 tribes of Israel for my millennial reign upon earth. It truly is as simple as that. The entrance of my word gives light. It gives understanding to the simple, to those who simply want to know the truth of my word. Some of the upcoming videos. Jesus asks, what if the rapture doesn't happen as you are expecting? Jesus explains the third temple, the so-called temple of God. Jesus explains Revelation Unraveled, a fresh approach to understanding the book of Revelation. Jesus explains tribulation and the wrath. What's the difference? Know the future in advance. Subscribe, like, and share this channel. Thank you.
Over the span of 2,000 years, we have been given an interconnected collection of 66 books written by 40 authors in various cultures, time periods, and languages. Today, we call this collection of ancient texts the Holy Bible. Upon investigation, we find that these 66 books combine to form a message to humanity from a being outside of space and time by writing history before it happens. Unique among all books ever written, the Bible accurately foretells specific events in detail many years, sometimes centuries, before they occur. Around 2,500 prophecies appear in the pages of the Bible, roughly 2,000 of which have already been fulfilled to the letter with no errors, and over 300 of those prophecies were fulfilled by Jesus of Nazareth. The Bible predicted the scattering of the Jews, the rebirth of Israel, brutal wars, devastating disasters, coming deceptions, strange signs and wonders, and a new world order thousands of years ago. It also tells us of a man who will rule this coming world empire and what his true intentions will be. All of this has been in the works for thousands of years, and it all hinges on Satan's ability to deceive mankind. All across this world, deceptions are increasing through false religions, distorted teachings, New Age spirituality, and moral relativism, as well as through the advent of deceptive phenomena in the skies above, and the desperation for a strong world leader to bring peace and safety here below. As a new chapter for mankind approaches, we see the persecution and decline of true Christianity, and the growing spread of apathy, desperation, and despair among all peoples of the world. Men and women are pulling away from the truth about our humanity, our reality, and the truth about who God, our Creator, truly is. All of this was predicted in the Holy Bible. The Apostle Paul in the 1st century AD wrote several letters to early churches, which are now called the Epistles. The far application of these letters are a clear warning for us today. It is a warning of impending deceptions. In his first letter to the Corinthians, he tells us, "Do not deceive yourselves. If any one of you thinks he is wise by the standards of this age, he should become a fool so that he may become wise." In a letter to the Romans, he describes those who willingly live in lies when he writes, "Their throats are open graves, their tongues practice deceit, poison of vipers is on their lips. For such people are not serving our Lord Christ, but their own appetites. By smooth talk and flattery, they deceive the minds of naive people." In a letter to Timothy, Paul clearly describes the world we see today when he writes, "The Spirit clearly says that in the latter times some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons." The Apostle Peter, disciple and eyewitness to Jesus' ministry, describes in his second letter how in the end times the world will mock and reject Jesus Christ as God when he writes, "First of all, you must understand this, that in the last days scoffers will come, scoffing and indulging in their own lusts, saying, 'Where is the promise of his coming? For ever since our ancestors died, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation.' They deliberately ignore this fact that by the word of God, heavens existed long ago, and the earth was formed out of water and by means of water, through which the world of that time was deluged with water and perished. But by the same word, the present heavens and earth have been reserved for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction of the godless. But do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed." In the second letter to the Thessalonians, Paul describes coming miraculous deceptions and a powerful world leader when he wrote, "Don't let anyone deceive you in any way, for that day will not come until the rebellion occurs and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the man doomed to destruction. Don't you remember that when I was with you, I used to tell you these things? And now you know what is holding him back, so that he may be revealed at the proper time. For the secret power of lawlessness is already at work, but the one who now holds it back will continue to do so until he is taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will overthrow with the breath of his mouth and destroy by the splendor of his coming. The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan, displayed in all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and lying wonders, and in every sort of evil that deceives those who are perishing. They are perishing because they refuse the love of the truth, and so be saved. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion, so they will believe the lie, and so that all will be condemned who have not believed the truth, but have delighted in wickedness." The Apostle John, while imprisoned on the island of Patmos, had a vision of the end times and the deceiving entities that will walk the earth, stating, "And the great dragon was cast out, the ancient serpent who is called devil and Satan, he who deceives the whole habitable world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. He deceives my own people who dwell on the earth because of the signs he was granted to do in front of the beast, saying to those who dwell on the earth that they should make an image of the beast who has the sword wound and lived." Jesus Christ himself gave his discourse of the end times when he stated clear warnings of the signs of the end. "Watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name claiming, 'I am the Christ,' and will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nations will rise against nations, kingdoms against kingdoms. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of the birth pains. Then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death. You will be hated by all nations because of it. At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. For then there will be a great distress unequaled from the beginning of the world until now, and never be equaled again. If those days had not been cut short, no one would survive. For the sake of the elect, those days will be shortened. At that time, if anyone says to you, 'Look, here's the Christ,' or 'There he is,' do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will appear and perform great signs and miracles to deceive even the elect if that were possible. See, I have told you ahead of time." We live in a fallen, messed up world, and ancient scriptures reveal to us that God is holy and perfect. Sin separates people from God, our Creator, and each other. And because we're all sinful and fall short of God's standard of perfection, God himself took on humanity as Jesus of Nazareth to offer mankind the free gift of salvation, to save us from sin and eternal spiritual death, and to give us the knowledge of truth and true spiritual freedom. God, through Jesus, paid the price for your sins and mine on the cross of Calvary. Jesus Christ died for the sins of all mankind. That means he died for the Buddhist, the Muslim, the Hindu, the atheist and agnostic, the Freemason, the New Ager, the Luciferian and Satanist, the world elite, and even me and you. But Jesus didn't stay dead. Jesus rose from the grave, conquering sin and death. You can receive Jesus right now and know God's peace and unconditional love right now at this very moment. Humanity has been given the gift of free will, and we all have a choice. We can choose to live life as our own God, living for ourselves, dwelling in darkness, rejecting God's plan of salvation, allowing sin and selfishness to rule our lives, and unwillingly support the work of Satan and his fallen angels. Or we can surrender our life to Jesus and be spiritually saved forever. There are no prerequisites, rituals, or tests for accepting God's free gift of salvation. All one needs to do is repent of your sins, confess your need for a Savior, and honestly ask Jesus to come into your heart, be Lord of your life, and help you walk in His light and truth. Jesus declared, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." Remember these truths. God loves you. God cares about you. God wants nothing more than to save you, restore you, and have His Holy Spirit dwell within you personally to guide you and help you overcome the heavy burdens of this world. As a new chapter dawns for mankind, I pray for you all and hope that the truth of Jesus Christ will indeed set you free.
In the book of Genesis, it says that the sons of God came into the daughters of men. They created a hybrid offspring who are called the Nephilim, or the fallen ones. They're referred to as the giants, or the mighty ones. Some believe they were between 8 and 15 feet tall.
This is handed down not only in the Bible. This is also handed down in Sumerian languages, that some of the gods had sex with humans and the offsprings were giants. Mythology is full of giants, and we have to look at these old myths with modern languages. Change the word of angel into extraterrestrial. In the beginning of time, extraterrestrials had sex with humans, and the product of this sexual contact were giants.
Is it possible that as geneticists continue to decode the human genome, they will find that among our various hominid ancestors is a missing link to enormous beings from another world?
Ancient DNA is perhaps, for me, the most important area of study in all of my work, because there is the potential chance here that we can find direct evidence of the ancestors of modern humans. I suspect we'll find lineages of a race of giants.
Could it be that just like some humans have traces of Neanderthal DNA, there could still be similar traces of alien human giants that scientists have yet to discover? Ancient astronaut theorists believe the answer is a profound yes, and suggest further insights could be revealed in early Judaic texts, which give a curious description of the world's first man, otherwise known as Adam. The Book of Genesis, Chapter 6. Placed just after the story of creation and the generations of Adam and Eve, this section of the Hebrew Bible contains a curious passage.
There is a very interesting teaching in older Kabbalistic traditions that dates back to temple times. Legend states that Adam originally was, by our definition, a giant. That the original Adamic race was not of the same physical stature as we human beings are today. Some claim that the original Adamic race were giants.
Is this an agenda of symbolism, or is there something actual to it?
Was the biblical Adam a giant? Could it be that all of humanity is descended from a race that was of a much greater stature? And that there was a time on Earth when giants were prevalent and humans were the anomaly?
When we look at the modern evolutionary cycle for human beings, it's still put on the shoulders of Darwinistic views. So anything that steps outside of those viewpoints is usually greatly challenged. Mainstream science has had a very hard time wrapping their head around the idea that there could have been a lost race, part extraterrestrial or part human.
In mythology, the giants were the fact they did exist. What we are missing are the bones of giants. From time to time, anthropologists found some big bones. But then other anthropologists contradicted it. But definitely giants did exist in the past. And they were the result of a mixture between extraterrestrials and humans.
Two incredible megalithic structures. Curious religious traditions repeated in culture after culture. And report.
Message 65, Before and After the 3 Days of Darkness. Cliff Kaufman, March 10, 2015. Comment from Cliff, Well peeps, this is long, and I wrote it long because inquiring minds want to and need to know details. It might answer some questions. It might produce more questions, that's natural. But if it makes you mad or crazy? Hey, save it for Jesus, okay? He's my literary agent and my bail bondsman too. So no matter what, he's got me covered. So get ready, cause this is a little something I've been sitting on. Heads up peeps. Don't forget you read it here. 1. Extreme and odd red skies dash greater than get into your house. Gather your immediate family, pets, water, canned food and do it quickly. Prepare for 3 days of complete darkness outdoors. The power will be off. Do not venture out. Keep windows and doors shut and locked. Curtains drawn closed. Do not even attempt to look outside during the darkness. You will see the red skies beforehand. This will be a sign. 2. Massive worldwide earthquake dash greater than stay in your house or the Goshen, safe house. You were directed to by the Holy Spirit. If you are who you should be, your house will be protected from destruction supernaturally, or you will be moved elsewhere to a safe Goshen by the HS. Either way, stay indoors. Prepare for the 3 days of darkness. You will feel the earth move. This will be a sign. 3. Terrestrial, cosmic worldwide event, greater than same as above. Get into your house. If you are who you should be, then you will be protected supernaturally in your house. Again, prepare for the 3 days of darkness happening soon after a huge cosmic event. You will see the event. This will be a sign. 4. 3 day of darkness, what to do during PT.1 dash greater than stay indoors. If you are who you are supposed to be, you will have light indoors. How you ask? God will supply it supernaturally. In some cases, food and water will be supplied as well on a case-by-case basis by God. Important. During the 3 days of darkness, you will hear strange things outside your home. You might even hear the familiar voice of a family member calling you to come outside and help them. Stop. Do not venture outdoors. It's a trick. Do not look out a window. It's not who you think it is. WHYUASK? Because the Lord Jesus has instructed many messengers that we are not to venture outdoors or open the windows, curtains or blinds. Here's why. At this time during the 3DOD, many powerful and extremely evil demons will have been released onto the earth. They are looking for anyone they might kill, possess and terrorize. That includes you. These are freshly released, wild-eyed devils right out of the pits of hell. They are extremely malevolent and hungry for human blood. They have been given license to murder, possess, terrorize, rape, burn, pillage and torture anyone they find outdoors and unprotected by God. These demon spirits will manifest themselves in many shapes, forms and sizes. They will take the form of extraterrestrials, ETs, hideous and repulsive forms that are frightening to look upon. These demons will even take the form of humans both dead and alive. So don't be fooled. 5. 3 Days of Darkness, What to Do PT. 2-Greater Than Gather your family around you. Explain to them what you know. Read your Bible to them. Pray together for protection. Stay in prayer as much as possible. Wait for the all clear when the daylight returns. Then seek out other Christians. Important, you may have a family member that is very close to the Lord Jesus disappear sometime during the first day of darkness. Do not freak out. It's a good thing. You will be informed of this by an angel that will appear to the rest of the family inside your house when it happens. Do not go outside looking for that person. The Lord Jesus has taken that person, who is one of God's elect, away to a safe place for special training and edification. Not to worry. That person will return after the 3DOD has ended. You will see that loved one again. Follow their instructions to the letter and everything will be fine. What's next? What do we do now after the 3DOD? Question mark, 6. The harvest begins. -Greater than. Not the rapture yet. This will be a very busy time for the elect of the Bride of Christ to begin to bring in all those lukewarm Christians that were clueless about Jesus' plan. It will also be a time to win lost souls for Jesus. A special group of multiple 1,000s of chosen Christians called the elect will begin roaming all over the earth supernaturally to start winning people to Christ. They will be sent out and work in groups of 2. These elect will also be assisted by millions of God's warrior angels that will be stationed on earth for this particular harvest period. These angels will afford protection and logistics for those new people being saved and brought into the kingdom. These new Christians that are being saved will be ushered to safe locations around the world to wait for the end of that particular harvest period. This harvest period will probably last 40 to 50 days. The exact number of days is up to Father God and has not specially been revealed to his messengers. The special elect members of the bride will be impervious to any and all of Satan's attacks while they work the harvest around the world. These ones can travel at light speed, arriving anywhere instantly. Good people everywhere around the world will recognize these chosen ones by sight. They will glow with their new glorified bodies given to them personally by Jesus himself. People that want to be saved or redeemed and want to know Jesus as their personal savior will run and flock to these elect ones. The people that want it will be ministered to at that time and be led to receive Jesus. These elect are untouchable by the enemies of God. They can go anywhere and do anything. They cannot be stopped by walls, fences, bullets or bombs. They can reach out to any person no matter where they might be kept or imprisoned. These elect have a very specific job to do and a limited amount of time to do it. They are on a mission for God and nothing will stop them from accomplishing it to God's full contentment. 6. At harvest end, rapture. -Greater than keep in mind that during this particular harvest time much is happening in the world. Chaos will be the order of the day. There will be mass destruction from many natural disasters that are taking place, worldwide earthquakes, flooding, volcanic eruptions, wars, tsunamis, food shortages, fresh drinking water will be non-existent. Looting, murders, demonic manifestations will be commonplace. Governments will have collapsed around the world. Nothing will be the same, no one will be safe outside of God's hand of protection. But, there is something even more devastating that happens during the 3 days of darkness. And that is all young children under the physical and spiritual age of accountability will be taken from the earth by God's angels. This will cause worldwide mass pandemonium when parents cannot suddenly locate their babies and young children. Many parents will lose their minds. Many will attempt suicide. Many will curse God and die. But many will also thank God that their children do not have to go through the horror taking place on the earth at that time. Those parents will seek God's help and forgiveness and come to know Him and join their children once again after the harvest is over and they are raptured. Then comes the rapture. The time or day no one but God the Father knows. This is officially known as the second rapture, since technically, a kind of mini-rapture took place when God removed His comparatively small group of chosen elect during the first day of darkness for training. Remember them? If not, go back and reread from the beginning. Now, I know a lot of this stuff is extra-biblical and it freaks a lot of very good folks out. This includes me as well at times. But Christians need to remember that God is doing a new thing and we are in the very last days. We are definitely the last generation. Everything I mentioned above will happen so extremely fast you won't even know what hit you. Even now things are starting to snowball on us. We can barely keep up with what is happening on huge scales around the world as it is. It's all going down right now, right here, and in our faces, and guess what? We have front row seats to this worldwide calamity about to go down. So, scream and holler all you folks want, but this is happening right now. Just because you don't believe in something doesn't stop that something from happening while you're in oblivious denial. When this all goes down, I hope and pray you will recall my words and do the right thing. And believe me, this is going to happen so quick you will freak out. You will panic. You will get on your knees in front of God and beg Him for help. But that's only if you survive the initial and constant destruction going on around the world at that time. Best advice: don't wait. Get right, right now, with Jesus Himself. Not hard to do. He's listening. Do it and get it done with. Become free in Jesus so that no matter what happens, you got this covered, man. For once in your life, really be smart. Do the right thing. Don't follow the crowd like you usually do. This one time. This is your moment. Jesus is saying, let's do this. Come home to me, I got you. Don't wait, kid. Tilly Cliff Kaufman, Mark Chen, good summary of many important points, Cliff Kaufman. Please allow me to write a few points of clarification, if you don't mind. 1. From what the Lord has confirmed to me, the young ones under the age of accountability will be taken to safety in a rapture situation before the great darkness commences, not during the 3 days of darkness. They will not be here to suffer the fear of these terrible signs which initiate the great darkness. 2. As for the elect who are gathered away first during the great darkness, we won't be going up to heaven at the time, as our training will be on earth. Hence, it isn't strictly an ascension type rapture. 3. We have to remember that God the Father and His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, will be visiting every living soul on earth during the time of the great darkness. They will remove the spiritual veil, and every person will have to make a choice then to either believe and receive Jesus Christ into their lives, or to persist in their sin and rebellion. This is the most important reason that God is bringing about the great darkness, to reveal Himself and His Son to this sleeping and sinful world, when all electronics, electrical items, vehicles and all forms of modern distractions will be quiet and stilled. Psalm 46 hours 10 minutes, message 65, before and after the 3 days of darkness. Cliff Kaufman, Mark Chen, 2015. Comment from Cliff: well peeps, this is long, and I wrote it long because inquiring minds want to and need to know details. It might answer some questions. It might produce more questions, that's natural. But if it makes you mad or crazy? Hey, save it for Jesus, okay? He's my literary agent and my bail bondsman too. So no matter what, He's got me covered. So get ready, cause this is a little something I've been sitting on. Heads up peeps. Don't forget you read it here. 1. Extreme and odd red skies dash greater than get into your house. Gather your immediate family, pets, water, canned food, and do it quickly. Prepare for 3 days of complete darkness outdoors. The power will be off. Do not venture out.